The second major group of plant pathogens is the group that contains the bacteria. You're probably familiar with these because certainly there are human diseases that are caused by bacteria. Amongst the plant pathogens, there are about 200 species of bacteria that can potentially cause diseases. These are relatively small organisms, certainly compared to the fungi that we just discussed. You really can't see these organisms with the naked eye. You'd really need a light microscope in order to see individual bacterial cells. The upside to bacteria compared to fungi is that they're relatively simple. They aren't complex, don't produce those fruiting bodies like fungi do. They're actually just unicellular organisms, so single-celled, and they have relatively simple reproduction. They reproduce by something called binary fission. Inside a bacterial cell, what you basically have is a bacterial wall, there's a membrane inside, and then there's this piece of bacterial DNA. It's a bacterial chromosome. And to reproduce, these organisms just basically make a copy of that bacterial chromosome. One copy goes to one end of the cell, other copy goes to the other end of the cell. You can kind of think of it just kind of pinching off in the center, and you end up with cells, each with a copy of that bacterial chromosome, and these bacteria are genetically identical. As I mentioned, bacteria are very small. In this particular slide, I'm showing you bacterial cells that have been photographed under a light microscope. The magnification here is probably around 1,000 times normal size. I've got a black arrow pointing towards a single bacterial cell. The bacterial cell is a little bit elongated. This is what's called a rod-shaped bacterial cell. Most bacteria are either rod-shaped or spherical. Most of the plant pathogens tend to be rod-shaped organisms. You'll notice the really pretty purple color. This is not natural. What we did here is stain the bacteria to make them more visible. They tend to be colorless, and so they're typically very difficult to see, and the staining actually makes them stand out a little bit. This particular organism causes a disease called bacterial ring rot. This is a very, very serious disease on potatoes. The organism is a vascular wilt pathogen, just like the fungi that cause Dutch elm disease and oak wilt. This organism gets into the water conducting tissue in potatoes, and eventually in the tubers it will cause decay around that vascular tissue. If you slice open a potato that has this particular disease, you'll see a discoloration in the vascular ring around the edge of the tuber, and if you squeeze that tuber, you can actually get this snot-like material that comes oozing out. This is a very destructive pathogen. If it gets into a potato field, it can basically decimate an entire crop. There's no tolerance for this pathogen in sea potato production. So if a sea potato producer finds this, he or she is banned from growing sea potatoes for a long, long period of time, on the order of a decade. In terms of symptoms caused by bacteria, bacteria oftentimes cause leaf spots. The leaf spots caused by bacteria oftentimes are a little bit different than those caused by fungi. I mentioned with fungi that leaf spots tend to be roughly circular. With the bacterial leaf spots, they're oftentimes angular. That is, if you look at those spots, oftentimes the edges look very, very straight. And that's because oftentimes bacteria get into leaves, they are able to colonize, but when they get to veins, they're not able to cross the veins, and the veins delimit the edge of the infected area. Also with bacterial leaf spots, oftentimes you see a slight yellow halo around the dead tissue. So anytime I see an angular leaf spot with a yellow halo, my first thought is that I'm probably dealing with a bacterial pathogen. The disease shown in this particular slide is one called bacterial brown spot. It's a disease that's near and dear to my heart because this is the disease that I studied for my PhD work. The bacterium that causes this disease is called Pseudomonas syringae pathivar syringae, and it's what's called an ice nucleating organism. I mentioned that bacteria, if you look at their structure, they have that bacterial chromosome, there's a membrane around that, and then an outer wall. In this particular bacterium, there's also an outer membrane, and embedded in that outer membrane is a protein that mimics an ice crystal. So this particular organism is involved in frost damage on plants. You can usually cool plants like a snap bean plant down to around 28 degrees Fahrenheit before they will spontaneously freeze. If you add a lot of this particular bacterium to the plant, it will actually freeze at a higher temperature, and that's because of this protein in the outer membrane that mimics an ice crystal. This particular phenomenon was actually discovered at the University of Wisconsin. There was a graduate student in the plant pathology department. He was studying a corn disease, and he was using leaves that were infected with a fungal pathogen. He was grinding those up and then spraying it across his plots as inoculum. And he did this one afternoon. There was a frost that evening, and all of the plots that he had inoculated frosted overnight, and the ones that he had not inoculated didn't freeze. And he eventually found that these leaves that he was grinding up were covered with this particular bacterium. In fact, this Pseudomonas organism is what's called an epiphyte. It actually naturally lives on leaf surfaces, oftentimes without causing disease. In this particular case, there was enough of the bacterium in this mix to induce frost damage on the plants. This particular organism has a useful application. Folks have used Pseudomonas, or at least the protein derived from it, to help make artificial snow. You can get a better sense of the angularity of bacterial infections in this particular slide. This is a disease called bacterial blight of begonia. Notice all of the brown tissue, which is where the bacterium has infected and caused the tissue to die. Also notice where the black arrow is pointing. You can see where the bacterium got up to a major vein and just wasn't able to get across that vein. So the vein serves as the edge of the infected area. You can also see the yellow halo around the infected tissue in this particular example. In order to verify that I'm dealing with a bacterial disease, what I do is take out a little bit of tissue at the interface of the live and dead part of that leaf. I put it in a drop of water on a microscope slide. I slice across it, put a cover slip over the top, and then I look at that cut edge. As I'm looking at it under the microscope, what I look for is granular material that's oozing out from that cut leaf tissue. And you can see that in the slide. There's a dark mass at the bottom, which is the mass of leaf tissue. And then you can see all of this granular material in the upper right. All of those little grains are bacterial cells that are oozing out from the cut leaf surface. This is called bacterial streaming. Now, I don't know exactly which bacterium is causing the problem, but at least I have some initial information that I am dealing with a bacterial infection. In addition to leaf spots, bacterial pathogens can also cause leaf blights. This is bacterial blight of geranium, a very common disease. If you ever grow geraniums and save your plants year after year, this is definitely a disease that you will probably eventually encounter. The disease typically starts as individual spots. You can see an example of that in the very center leaf in this particular photo. There are a couple of kind of angular defined leaf spots with yellow halos. Eventually, the infected area will become larger and kind of wedge-shaped. You can see that in the right leaf in this particular photo. You get this movement of the bacteria from the edge of the leaf back towards the petiole, so it'll look kind of like a pie-shaped infected dead area on the leaf. Again, you can see a yellow halo, and then eventually when the bacterium gets to the main stem, it will cause the collapse of the petiole and the entire leaf will collapse, and that's why we call it a blight. Again, this is a disease that you're going to see if you grow geraniums and tend to keep your plants and overwinter them. Oftentimes, geraniums harbor this particular bacterium without showing symptoms, and it's only over time that the bacterial population increases to the point where infection and disease occur. The best way to manage this particular disease is simply to discard infected plants. There's really no way to clean them up or cure the plants once they have this bacterial disease, and you don't want to keep them around because potentially the bacterium could get transferred from the infected plants to healthy plants and lead to additional disease. Once you've discarded the plants, then what you need to do is decontaminate, and you can use a 10% bleach solution or 70% alcohol to do this. So decontaminate pots, decontaminate any surfaces that may have come into contact with the infected plants or any other objects or surfaces that may be contaminated. Certain bacterial pathogens can also cause soft rots, and these are relatively slimy, kind of juicy looking decays on plant parts. The most notorious of these is bacterial soft rot, which oftentimes affects different types of vegetable crops, including potatoes and broccoli, cauliflower. Pretty much any type of plant part can be susceptible. If you've ever had a potato tuber or a bag of potatoes that has kind of liquefied in your refrigerator, then you've encountered bacterial soft rot. What's very interesting about this particular disease is that the bacterium infects and digests the pectin in the plant. Pectin is the glue that holds the plant cells together. So when you get an infection with soft rot bacteria, they tend to cause the tissue to collapse and kind of liquefy. If you take a look at that liquefied tissue, you will see that there are still live plant cells there. It's just that that glue that holds them together has been eaten away. This disease can be a really serious issue in potato storage. when they store potatoes commercially, they are in these huge buildings, mountains of potatoes. And if you end up getting bacterial soft rot, it can liquefy one of these piles in a matter of 2 to 3 days. You can actually climb up onto these mountains of potatoes, and you have to be very, very careful, because if there happens to be a pocket of bacterial soft rot, you can take a step as you're walking across the potatoes and end up sinking in. I do know of some people that have been inspecting these stored potatoes, have been walking along, taken a step, and ended up to their waist in rotten, smelly potatoes. Now, I have to mention that the odor that you associate with rotting potatoes really isn't due to the bacterial soft rot organism. That particular organism really doesn't smell that bad. But what happens is, once the bacterial soft rot organism decays the tubers, that decayed tissue becomes a nice growth medium for a variety of other types of bacteria, particularly organisms like Clostridium, which produce a lot of butyric acid, and that's really what gives the rotten potatoes the really foul smell. And I have to say, I'm not a big fan of getting soft rotted potatoes into my lab, because that odor tends to permeate everything. And the worst part is that after a while, when you've worked with these tubers, you don't even notice that there's a bad smell. Another interesting story about bacterial soft rot comes from one of my colleagues who had a friend who worked as an extension agent in California and was called out to diagnose a problem in a broccoli field. And as it turned out, it was bacterial soft rot. They ended up having to diagnose this particular problem from the road using binoculars, because the stench of the rotten broccoli was so absolutely awful. In terms of a bacterial disease that you're most likely able to identify by eye, your best bet is probably with this particular disease. It's called bacterial wilt, and it's a problem on a variety of different types of cucurbits. So that includes the pumpkin, squash, cucumber, those sorts of vegetable crops. This particular bacterium is introduced into plants by cucumber beetles. They actually drop the bacterium off as they are feeding. The bacterium gets into the water conducting tissue and blocks it off. So this is actually a vascular wilt disease. And the bacterium produces a very slimy capsule around its cells. And it's actually in part that slimy capsule that blocks up the water conducting tissue in the plant. Initially, when you see symptoms of this disease, what you're going to see are individual vines that begin to wilt. You can see a couple of vines in this particular photo that have wilted severely. But if you take a look at the rest of the plant, which is in the upper left corner, you'll notice that the rest of the plant, at least at this point, is still healthy. This bacterium will spread throughout the plant, however, and eventually the entire plant will die. The best way to manage this disease is to keep cucumber beetles in check. To confirm bacterial wilt of cucurbits, what you need to do is cut off one of those wilted vines right at the base, and then cut off a section that's about 6 to 8 inches long, so you end up with two pieces of vine. Pull those apart for about 10 seconds, bring them back together, and rub them very gently, slowly for about 10 seconds, and then very slowly pull those two pieces of vine apart. And if you have bacterial wilt, then what you will oftentimes see are these strands of spiderweb-like material that will form in between those two cut pieces. I'm showing that here in this particular slide. There's a black arrow pointing towards one of those slimy strands. And what you're actually doing is pulling out strands of bacteria from the vascular tissue that are all held together by that slimy capsule that I mentioned. Now, this won't work on all types of cucurbits, but if you're dealing with bacterial wilt on cucumber, on that particular host, oftentimes you will see these bacterial strands associated with the disease. Finally, the last group of symptoms that I tend to associate with bacterial pathogens are the galls. Galls are basically undifferentiated masses of plant tissue that are caused by, in this particular case, infection by a bacterial pathogen. Certainly, there are fungal galls and galls caused by other types of disease-causing organisms. There are also galls that are caused by non-diseases, so abiotic factors. But kind of the classic galls, in my mind, are caused by bacteria. The one that's shown here is something called crown gall. This is caused by a bacterium called Agrobacterium tumefaciens. This particular organism is oftentimes found in soil. It will infect roots and also oftentimes infects right at the base of the plant at the soil line, thus its name crown gall. And I've got a black arrow pointed to this large undifferentiated mass of plant tissue that's been induced by infection by this particular bacterium. What the organism does is it oftentimes gets in through wounds, and inside the bacterial cell, I've mentioned that there's a bacterial chromosome. This particular bacterium, in addition to that chromosome, also has a second piece of DNA. It's a circular piece of DNA called a plasmid, And there's a section of that DNA that actually gets cut out of that plasmid and injected into plant cells, where it incorporates itself into the plant chromosomes. That particular little piece of bacterial DNA codes for a variety of proteins. Many of them are enzymes, and these enzymes help produce a group of compounds called the opines, and these opines are one of the favorite food sources for this particular bacterium. As part of all of this protein production from that little piece of DNA, you get this undifferentiated growth, lots of cells, cells enlarge, and you get this kind of mass of plant growth that's produced, again, caused by this infection by the bacterium. Interestingly, scientists realized that what they could do would be to take that plasmid, cut out most of that group of genes that are involved in the formation of the galls, and then they can insert other types of plant genes or other genes in general into that little section of DNA, incorporate that DNA back into the plasmid, and then what they could do is stick the plasmid back into the Agrobacterium cell, have Agrobacterium do its normal infection process, and using this method, they could actually incorporate foreign genes into plants. Use of this bacterium was one of the first methods for genetically engineering plants.